All right, the room has filled up pretty well, so let's go ahead and begin. And if you would, join me in prayer as we start. Lord our God, we come to you, Father, through the Son and in the Holy Spirit, to praise you, to thank you, to worship you, and especially as we approach the subject matter today, to thank you for your unfailing love and your gift of transformation to our denomination. Some of the things we may deal with today are painful for some. Give us comfort and healing in our pain. Heal us, O Lord. And I pray that you will bless that which is said and that which is heard, that we may speak the truth in love, but speak the truth and appreciate it from your love. So bless our time together, heal our hearts and our minds. Bless again, not only what is said, but especially just bless what is heard and what is taken away. And may it be therapeutic and may it be healing as well as informative. We thank you for that and ask it in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so the Adventist roots of Grace Communion International, some people don't know that our roots are Adventist. We are by our tribe, as they say, out of the history of Christianity, is Adventist. We were not, as we thought for many years, unique, hardly, one and only, hardly, but rather a part of a long tradition that of a tree that began with the followers of Jesus in the first century and that branched out over the centuries into many different streams of discipleship. And the stream that we have flown out of is the Adventist tradition. I want to begin our story with a little bit of background. We'll start as early as 1730 to 1750 with what has been called the First Great Awakening. The First Great Awakening was a Christian religious revitalization movement that swept the Atlantic region, especially the American colonies. So this is before even we became a country, the United States. We were still the British colonies at this time. And this awakening launched the evangelical Christian movement in America. Churches moved away. Maybe I should back up just a moment and say, well, what had the churches been prior to this? Can you name some denominations?
Anglican.
Yeah, predominantly Anglican. Puritans, out of the Reformed tradition. Quakers, Presbyterians. Yeah, a few of those in the sewer of the colonies, which was Rhode Island, that's what it was called. That's because the Anabaptists went there. So you had a few trends, but very much what we might call Anglican, some Catholics in Maryland, and Reformed tradition. In other words, some of your mainstream kind of churches. And what did the worship tend to look like among the Puritans and the Anglicans and so forth? Yeah, pretty ritual, stiff, formal, so forth. So here now, the First Great Awakening. And this launches the evangelical movement in the colonies. Churches move away from ritual and ceremony and into powerful preaching about guilt, the dangers of hell, and the need for personal salvation. That's a little different from most Anglican, Puritan, and other churches of the day. Worship services became more experiential and emotional. They reached out to all classes, including the slaves. Now here the seeds are sown for the future of Emancipation Proclamation. Because when they shared Jesus with the slaves, they also began to teach the slaves to read English. And they began to read the Bible. And when a slave begins to read the Bible and they read the book of Exodus, they begin to say, "Let my people go." So The seeds were sown, but one of the great benefits was that this no longer was a class system that some of the other churches, Anglican and others, had just sort of said. And the irony is that people came to the New World for what, as we were taught in our history class? Freedom of religion. And as soon as they got here, they banned freedom of religion. Only theirs, the one and only true religion now. And so, but this movement shook all of that up. So it didn't last long. Even in the colonies, there was already this desire for freedom of religion and sharing the gospel with all classes and all people groups. And this is what is going to make America. But it also creates the religious climate that we're going to talk about here this morning. Now, early in the 1800s, we had what has come to be called the Second Great Awakening in America. Now, this one focused on unbelievers, on getting decisions for Christ, and getting America right with God, and getting people saved in preparation for the soon coming of Christ. Now, does that sound familiar? Well, you can see that on television today. The same message is still going out. That's a very fundamentalist, evangelical message, but it arose out of the first, and then the Second Great Awakening began to put emphasis on these things and began to form a religious milieu in the United States of America. Now, those leaders in this movement used revivals, crusades, and camp meetings. If you've read of, was it the Cane Ridge camp meeting in Kentucky where thousands of people came and many, you know, it was like Woodstock. There were drugs, there was alcohol, there was sex, there was everything, and thousands of people, and some actually found the Lord there, though, but thousands came. And one of my favorite groups, Creedence Clearwater Revival, Creedence Clearwater was a revival. Yeah, it was, and it was these were big camp meetings that were quite powerful and emotional, and really formed a religious backdrop for our country, even being what it is today, though we've moved away from Christianity a lot, but it formed the basis of what would be the United States. Now, these revivals resulted in many new believers and many new denominations. So you don't want to be an Anglican or a Presbyterian or a Puritan or an Anabaptist anymore. We've moved beyond that. We're out there. We're experiencing things. And so new denominations begin to rise and begin to emerge as people begin to experience and express their worship differently from the way it's been done before. Now, along about this time, a movement appears called the Restorationist Movement. The Restorationist Movement was the notion that now that we have broken free of these old churches and their formal and staid worship, we've gotten away from the New Testament. We need to restore New Testament primitive Christianity. If it's not in the New Testament, we don't do it. They believed that there had been a conspiracy. That the Roman Catholic Church had introduced paganism in the place of Christianity. Oh. And that the Christian church had become pagan with its rituals and its symbols and so forth. And we need to break free of all of that and get back to the New Testament. Now, the interesting thing, of course, is every little group had a different idea of what the New Testament said. But the idea was, if it's not in the New Testament, we don't do it. Christmas! I don't see that in the New Testament. You see Christmas in the New Testament? We don't do it. The Catholic pagan thing. Easter! Do you see Easter? Oh, wait, it is in the King James Version, the word. But, you know, quickly, let's be scholarly enough to say that's Passover. We don't do Easter. That's pagan. The Catholics, again, brought all this paganism in. So no Easter. Sunday, do you see Sunday in the New Testament? I don't see Sunday. They kept the Sabbath. Jesus kept the Sabbath. The apostles kept the Sabbath. And I keep the Sabbath. It's New Testament. Trinity. You see the Trinity in the New Testament? There's no word Trinity in the New Testament. We don't believe in the Trinity. You see pianos in the New Testament? I don't see pianos. Seriously, I'm serious. We don't see pianos in the New Testament. No pianos in our church. I don't see any musical instruments in the New Testament. Now, how did they miss the harps in Revelation? At least you could have a harp. But no musical instruments. And you know churches I'm talking about. But I don't see any musical instruments in the New Testament. And I always said, I don't see any great grandmothers in the New Testament, but I believe in them. But I think you begin to see this notion arising, and many people in this time period began to adopt this restorationist movement notion. And it influenced the beginning of a number of churches. So some of the churches influenced by restorationism are the Christadelphians. Mm-hmm. Familiar with them. The Christian Connection. The Churches of Christ in all their various forms. Campbellites and others. And as you know, there's today the musical Church of Christ and the non, at least instrumental, Church of Christ. The Latter-day Saints. The Seventh-day Adventists, the Church of God's Seventh Day, Jehovah's Witnesses, and others all were affected in their thinking and their origins and their leadership by this restorationist movement of primitive Christianity, only doing what's in the New Testament. The Catholic Church is a false church. It's pagan, and it's introduced paganism into Christianity and indeed has replaced New Testament Christianity with a lot of paganism. Now, this leads us to we're in the early 1800s. Let's see if I can get this to go. The early 1800s in Western New York State. Why did this happen in Western New York State? Oli, do you know why? It's your fault. You're there.
You know what? The scars of it are still there.
Scars of it are still there, he says.
And along the Susquehanna, the Mormons just bought a huge tract of land. They're going to build a huge monument to the Aaronic priesthood of the Mormon Church.
There you go. Anybody else here from Western New York State? Yes.
Yeah, it's still that way.
Still that way.
Yeah. We ran from a Seventh-day Adventist church that was founded by Ellen G. White. And they ran in their newsletter recently, this is in Syracuse, they ran in their newsletter recently the history of their congregation, and it goes all the way back to there. They have a huge boarding school located in Union Springs, which is just south Rochester and Syracuse. They have camp meeting every year for 2 weeks. I mean, it's all very, very active, but it was also political as well. The women's movement started there. The abolition movement started there. So that's why it's known as the Burnover District.
Yeah. Lots of sociological, geographical, philosophical, political reasons, but it happened in Western New York State in the early 1800s. And one newspaper reporter writing about the phenomena that was just overwhelming in Western New York State called it the Burned Over District. And what he meant was that the fuel were the unconverted. And he burned them and got them converted. So they were burned over and converted. The whole section of Western New York converted to what? Matter of opinion. You had there the Fox sisters who were spiritualists. It's part of the women's movement. But here women come into leadership, which is non-traditional. And the women were spiritualists. They combined seances and that type of thing with Christianity, and quite popular, but it was an avenue for women to rise in leadership in the church. We had the Shakers. Now, why did they call them the Shakers? They shook a little, yeah, they shook. In fact, some of them shook a lot. So in the worship, they would shake. So they became known as the Shakers. Now, I'm amazed that the Shakers still continue to this day, particularly around Albany, New York. And I remember when we lived in New Hampshire, we got our raw milk from a Shaker farm. Now, the problem with, one of the difficulties and challenges of the Shakers is they don't tend to have second and third generations because they're celibate. So they have to recruit from outside, but they continue to exist to this day, and as you know, they're wonderful people and live an interesting lifestyle. It's back to nature and all that sort of thing, but the Shaker movement and the whole concept of that arose in Western New York State in the 1800s.
None of us here.
And the Oneida Society, if you remember them, one of the earliest kind of socialistic communes. And of course, they had a group marriage concept. In other words, everyone was married to everyone else, which is kind of an interesting philosophy. A very popular one. And the Oneida Society grew quite large. And interestingly, I don't know, a little tidbit, a little piece of trivia, Guillaume, the man who shot, now my mind goes blank, but
McKinley.
Not McKinley,
Garfield.
Yeah, thank you. The man who shot Garfield came out, was from the Oneida Society. He got kicked out or left, as he said, depending on who you listen to, but he was a part of that socialistic, commune, spiritualistic lifestyle. But the Oneida Society was quite popular. And there were other socialist communes as well in Western New York State. And of course, that's where a man came by the name of Joseph Smith, who you may have heard of. Joe Smith, that sounds like an alias. Is that a real name? No. But Joseph Smith, and of course Joseph Smith was a treasure hunter. He felt God would lead him to buried and hidden treasure, and he was out looking. And sure enough, an angel, as you know the story, by the name of Moroni, and all the jokes then began to follow. But the angel known as Moroni came and delivered him the tablets of gold with a thing and you know, the hat and the what we call the Books of Mormon and so forth. And the Mormons, the Latter-day Saints, Mormons originated with Joseph Smith in, where else? Western New York State. And among all of these religions that are popping up, new denominations and new ways of worship, there was a man by the name of William Miller. And to him we want to turn. William Miller, from 1782 to 1849. He was from Vermont, but he moved to Western New York State. Should have stayed in Vermont. But he moved to Western New York State, where he became a Baptist lay pastor eventually. He had begun his life as a deist. You know what a deist is, anybody? Help me out here, what's a deist?
A deist is an individual who believed that God created man and then just left him alone, has no personal relationship with God.
Right.
Right.
Kind of the concept is they say God created the watch and wound it and then left it alone to run. So he was a deist, but he became converted to Christianity. Well, his deist friends, when William Miller converted to Christianity, he was challenged to prove God exists and that the Bible is God's inspired word. Can you imagine somebody being challenged like that? Is there a God, and is the Bible his word? Well, those were the two challenges that William Miller faced upon his conversion to Christianity. And as I said, he eventually settled by being a Baptist lay pastor. But Miller's intense study of the Bible, two questions followed by an intense study of the Bible, convinced him that the time of Christ's return was revealed in Bible history. Now, he was not the first, but he is the American man who's known and even worldwide known as the key figure in this line of thinking. Using what is called the historicist hermeneutic, you say, what in the world is the historicist hermeneutic? Well, let me tell you, you may recognize it. A day for a year. So using the historicist hermeneutic of a day for a year, which was espoused by Adam Clark in his commentary, and Alexander Hislop in The Two Babylons, which William Miller loved those books, and so did a gentleman who came along later by the name of Herbert Armstrong, who has those in his library, well marked and well studied. So following Adam Clark and Alexander Hislop, William Miller interpreted Daniel 8:14, which says, "Unto 2,300 days then shall the sanctuary be cleansed," as 2,300 days. I still have that article in my files, the 2,300 days of Daniel. So he said it was from 457 BC, the decree of Artaxerxes to rebuild Jerusalem, to the date when Christ would return to cleanse the sanctuary, and that would be between March 21st, 1843, and March 21st, 1844, Jesus would return to the earth. Well, when March 21st, 1843, and I should say too that he had thousands of followers, not only in the United States, but he had an international following. He was big news. He had a friend in Boston who was attracted to what he was teaching and began to publish him. So not only did he do personal appearances, he did publishing to promote this concept, and so many people were ready for Christ to return. So when March 21st, 1843 came and went, what happened?
Nothing.
Oops. Now, has that ever stopped anybody? Does anybody ever say, well, maybe my theology and reasoning are wrong? Maybe my interpretation is incorrect? No, you just set a new date. I don't know if you know Steve Brown, who was a friend of our church from the Reformed Theological Seminary right here in Orlando. He had a TV show, and he had Hal Lindsey on as a guest. And so Steve Brown said, Hal, thank you for being here. Great privilege to have you, all that. And he said, now you wrote this book, The Late Great Planet Earth. Sold over 8 million copies, one of the biggest selling books in the history of the United States. Congratulations. Well, thank you very much. He said, now in your book, you said that Jesus was going to come back in 1975. Hal, what happened? And as you might expect, Hal Lindsey said, well, you know, hokey pokey, old soft shoe, the church wasn't ready, Christ was preparing his bride, and so he had to wait for us. And okay, thank you, Hal. Now, Hal, a few years later, you wrote Satan is Alive and Well and Living on Planet Earth, sold over 6 million copies. Hal, congratulations. What an accomplishment. Well, thank you very much. In that book, you said Christ was going to come in 1982. How, what happened? And it never ends. You just keep setting new dates. Never stop to say, is my whole line of reasoning wrong? Have I misunderstood? Am I not interpreting Scripture properly? No. That doesn't come up. So, when March 21st, 1843 came and went, a new date, April 18th, 1844 was set, using the Karaite Jewish calendar rather than the rabbinic calendar. So you see, the problem was not in setting the dates, the problem was in which calendar to use. So let's just pull out another calendar. And now it's going to be April 18th, 1844. What happened?
Nothing.
Nothing. Well, in August 1844, at a camp meeting in Exeter, New Hampshire, and I was amazed that I've had the privilege of being in almost every place I'm going to mention that these things occurred by virtue of working in New England for 12 years. But in August 1844, at a camp meeting in Exeter, New Hampshire, Samuel Snow, a co-worker of William Miller's, presented his conclusions using Miller's basic chronology, but adding ancient Israel festival typology. You see, because the festivals of ancient Israel reveal God's plan of salvation. Wow. So he selected the Day of Atonement as the date for Christ's return. They might say, why not the Feast of Trumpets? Well, the Feast of Trumpets really doesn't make a lot of sense if you know anything about the significance of that. But I won't even go into that. But the Day of Atonement makes more sense. Anybody remember what happened in ancient Israel every 49th year, at the conclusion of the 49th year on the Day of Atonement, what happened? Jubilee year, which is called the year of the year of release, year of the Lord, the acceptable year of the Lord. Beautiful imagery, the freedom, the release, God reigns, all debts are forgiven. That's a good, now that's some nice symbolism. Of course, it doesn't work out with anything else, but that's a nice little symbolism right there. So he said, that's the thing. We use the guy, but we got our date wrong because we need to understand how the holy days reveal God's plan. And because of that, the meaning of the Day of Atonement, Jesus is going to return in 1844 on the Day of Atonement. So thus, Miller was on the right track, he said, using those exact words. He was on the right track with the right year, but Christ would return on October 22nd, 1844. So, what did people do? Waited and sold their farms and quit their jobs and left their families and bought white ascension robes because, you know, that's the fashion in heaven. You don't want to be ready for that. And they went out to all over the world, but particularly, of course, in Western New York State, too. As Ole was telling me, he's been there, Ascension Mountain. They went up to Ascension Mountain just outside of Saratoga Springs, New York. That was the bulk of the group with William Miller. And they waited for the Lord to return. What happened? Nothing! Again! So what have historians come to call this experience that the Millerites, as they now had come to be called?
Great disappointment.
Great disappointment. The great disappointment. So following the great disappointment, most Millerites by this time had begun to be called Adventists. What does Advent mean? Coming of Christ, first and second, but the coming of Christ. And so since they had done all this, everybody just called them a bunch of Adventists who were waiting for the coming of Christ. So the Adventists, who have been estimated to have been between 50,000 and 500,000 worldwide. Now, that's the range of the estimate. Nobody can say for sure, but even 50,000 is quite a group. But 500,000 worldwide is indeed a significant impact. So, what are they going to do?
Pick a
new date? Viewpoints and explanations proliferated among those who still believed. Some just gave up religion altogether. Others splintered into different groups with different leaders. Can you imagine that phenomenon occurring? When suddenly you realize everything you've believed and taught just didn't work out, a certain phenomena happens. Some people just leave and others coalesce around new leaders and form new groups. So viewpoints and explanations proliferated among those who still believe. While Miller, a Baptist, accepted the Trinity, many of his followers had come from traditions that were Arian. Who can tell me what that means? Who were the Arians? Who was Arius?
They believed in God.
Yes, Jesus was a created being. Perhaps he became godly in his resurrection, but he was a created being. Some thought he was Michael, the archangel who had been sent to earth to be Jesus. Some thought he was just a created human who got so good that he was deified at his resurrection, etc., etc. But that there was only one God and that Jesus was not God. but was a created being, and traditions differ on what kind of created being he was. So William Miller had Trinitarians in his group, but he also had a lot of Arians in his group. So as they began to coalesce around different leaders after the Great Disappointment, new groups of Adventists began to form, and we have one called the Jehovah's Witnesses. From 1870 to 1875, Charles Taze Russell studied Millerite Adventist doctrine with two Millerite teachers, George Storrs and George Stetson, and adopted many of their teachings. Not all, but many of their teachings. As you know, the Jehovah's Witnesses do not accept the Trinity. They hold a form of Arianism. Russell believed that God gave Jesus the gift of divinity at his resurrection, thus Jesus became a God. And if you've seen the New World Translation, it's convenient to make your own translation that fits your doctrines, but the New World Translation of John 1:1 is, in the beginning there was the Word, and the Word was with the God, and the Word was a God. Now, as you know, there are no indefinite articles in the Greek. So you can just pop in whatever you want there. And so they popped in the articles that they preferred to support that. And as you probably know, they don't accept Christmas, and they don't do birthdays, and they don't do Easter, and they don't do a lot of things. But it comes out of that Adventist tradition. In 1881, Russell founded the Zion Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, out of which would eventually emerge the, what we call today, Jehovah's Witnesses. Another group that came out of the followers of William Miller came to be known as the Seventh-day Adventists. A lady by the name of Rachel Oakes Preston was a Seventh-day Baptist. Interesting. I don't know how many of you remember our old correspondence course on the history of the church. But yeah, I read it, studied it. And when I went to Boston, Massachusetts in 1970, I thought, what a great opportunity, because the first true church of God in the colonies was in Newport, Rhode Island. And according to our correspondence course, the Sabbatarian Church of God was still there. So I'm going down there. So I went, I made an appointment, called ahead, went down, had to show my ordination credentials to get into their library, but they welcomed me very openly. But the first thing I noticed was it wasn't a Sabbatarian Church of God, it was a Seventh-day Baptist Church of God. That's not what we said in the correspondence course. So I went in, I checked the files, and I compared them with what our correspondence course said. In our correspondence course, it said they were true believers because they kept the seven-day Sabbath, because that's the sign that you are a true Christian, is the seven-day Sabbath. And and they kept the annual holy days, because right here it says that from, you know, in October, in the fall of the year, they kept their annual convention, which obviously was the Feast of Tabernacles. No, it wasn't. It was their annual convention. It wasn't even on the dates of the Feast of Tabernacles. But in our correspondence course, we claimed that they kept the Feast of Tabernacles and all these. No, they didn't. They were Baptists, for pity's sake. They were Seventh-day Baptists, but they were Baptists. They were Trinitarians. And I asked the pastor there, I said, so you're Trinitarian? He said, well, most of us are. He says, we're Baptists. You're free to believe whatever you want. We don't make anything a test of fellowship, except maybe drinking alcohol and dancing, you know, other than that. Other than that, we're pretty open on all of our doctrines. Now, let me add something else, which is interesting. If you've ever read our book, The True History of the True Church, written by Herman Hay, Dr. Hay followed Duggar and Dodd, and I'll get to them in a minute, of the Church of God's Seventh-day history. But we traced our ancestry back. How can you always find the true church in history? Sabbath keepers. So everywhere our researchers saw Sabbatarians or Sabbath, we assume they were the true church. Well, what we fail to appreciate is that Sabbatarianism is not synonymous with the keeping of the seventh day. Sabbatarianism means that you keep one day holy. They were all Sunday keepers. They just kept it holy from midnight to midnight without work and all that sort of thing, but they were Sunday keepers. So the entire premise of that booklet just fades away. All right, so we got Rachel Oakes Preston, who was a Seventh-day Baptist. And upon moving to Washington, New Hampshire, I don't know if Carolyn Tatham Rakestraw, if she's here, but her family is from that area and have been there to this place on a number of occasions. Moving to Washington, New Hampshire, she began attending a Millerite Adventist church. She convinced the pastor and members of the church of the biblical mandate to keep the seventh-day Sabbath. Then the pastor convinced a Millerite writer, Thomas Preble, and Preble wrote a tract that played a major role in convincing some Millerite Adventists of the seventh-day Sabbath. It was published in February-March 1845 in their magazine called The Hope of Israel in Portland, Maine, showing that the seventh day should be observed as the Sabbath. Now, interesting, if you go back and you see the titles of some of these tracts and things, so many of them went something like this. Which day is the Christian Sabbath? That was their line of thinking. Now, the tract convinced a man by the name of J.N. Andrews. Anybody recognize Andrews?
Andrews University.
Which is the major university of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, yes. So the tract convinced J.N. Andrews, an avid anti-Trinitarian. So you see how these streams are beginning to coalesce and come together. And Joseph Bates, another man, a pastor of the Seventh-day Sabbath. Well, when Adventist Joseph Bates read Preble's work in 1845, he traveled to Washington, New Hampshire, and met with the members of what had become the first Seventh-day Observing Adventist Church. Bates then wrote several books on which day is the Christian Sabbath. For example, he wrote The Seventh-day Sabbath, A Perpetual Sign. And he became known as the Apostle of the Sabbath. Now, Bates was a close friend of James and Ellen G. White. Bates believed the Whites were gifted by God, especially Ellen, because she had visions. James White also published a newsletter read by many Millerite Adventists, and Bates convinced the Whites of the mandate to observe the seventh-day Sabbath. Together, Bates and the Whites came to have a growing following among the Millerites. As you see, what's happening here? Again, the splinter groups, as we call them today, begin to coalesce around new leaders. And as they coalesce around new leaders, even as we've seen in the splinter groups we're familiar with in our own tradition, they began to go their own little doctrinal nuances and ways. They have a central core, but then they began to develop their own particular take on their doctrines. So together, Bates and Whites began to have a following among the Millerites. Bates urged the Millerites to take physical health seriously. He was a vegetarian and believed dogmatically in vegetarianism and emphasized that whatever direction the Adventists were going, they needed to be concerned about their physical health and their diet. And Bates also urged their growing number of followers, we need to get organized into a denomination. So he convinced the Whites of vegetarianism, and doggone, if I may use that word, Ellen G. White had a vision then that God told her that in the latter days, all meat was unclean. So concern for people's health and the necessity of a vegetarian diet, the Whites helped a young man get a medical degree and then appointed him the director of what came to be called the Seventh-day Adventist Battle Creek Sanitarium, Battle Creek, Michigan. And along with his brother, this young man developed an alternative to the typical heavy eggs and meat and gravy breakfast of the day. The young men were named Kellogg. William Keith and John Harvey. And they discovered that first they tried turning wheat grains into flakes and didn't work quite so well. So they tried corn. Corn worked very well and produced a tasty little flake that they came up with the name Corn Flakes. They were later visited by a fellow Adventist by the name of Charles William Post. Who learned from them and went on to invent Postum and Grape Nut Flakes, Post Toasties. Now, he invented Postum because Ellen G. White and Bates and also began to teach that caffeine was harmful and we need to avoid caffeine, and Adventists to this day avoid caffeine. So what do you drink in the morning? Well, he invented Postum so you could drink that. Grape Nut Flakes is interesting. He thought that they had a fruity smell, so he grape, and they had a nut-like crunchiness because he called them grape nuts. And if you know Seinfeld's routine, grape nuts, what's with that? They're not grapes, they're not nuts. But the cereal industry in the United States was really spawned out of Adventism and vegetarianism. So they're a part of our history and our ancestry. On October 1st, 1860, at a conference in Battle Creek, Michigan for Sabbatarian Adventists, many followers of Bates and White approved the name Seventh-day Adventist to describe themselves. And in 1863, a denomination was formalized with the name, officially now, Seventh-day Adventist. And today, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has over 16 million members and is the 12th largest denomination in the world. The Seventh-day Adventist Church began with Arianism. Remember what that is? They began with Arianism because of Andrews and others. But with the influence of Ellen G. White, who has been called in some Adventist writings a closet Trinitarian, by the early 1900s, they had more of a Trinitarian view. In my estimation, it was more tritheistic, if you know what I mean. They didn't quite get the perichoresis yet. But at least they had moved from being Arian and having Michael, the archangel, become Jesus, to more of a at least tritheistic, quasi-Trinitarian. They would describe themselves today, if you look at their website, they will call themselves Trinitarian. And as you probably know, the Seventh-day Adventists have now celebrate Christmas, which they didn't. So the Seventh-day Adventists have made a journey toward evangelicalism, and the evangelical church is pretty open to accepting Seventh-day Adventists as brothers and sisters in Christ today. They've come a long ways. In fact, when we made our transformation, of course, that sent repercussions through all the Sabbath-keeping communities out there. So the Seventh-day Adventist leadership invited, at least I know Joe and Mike, and I think Greg Albrecht, who else, to come and meet with them because they wanted to discuss what had happened. They were both positive that it could happen to them and fearful that it could happen to them. So they wanted to discuss it. And as Joe tells the story, and I'll try to repeat it, and I hope I do an accurate job of it, but it's my version of Joe's story. When they were there, they said, well, we'd like you to have dinner with us at a restaurant this evening. And we understand that you do consume alcoholic beverages. And of course, Adventists do not. But if you, in the spirit of fellowship and brotherhood in Christ, if you want to order some wine, please feel free to do so, and we will join with you in drinking the wine. And Joe said, well, no, that's not necessary. We don't need any wine. Oh, we really urge you to feel free to order some wine.
So they poured it and rubbed down the side of the glass.
But anyway, amusing. So the Seventh-day Adventist Church have come a long ways, but they still, you know what their big hang-up still is. The Sabbath. They just, but they've changed in many, many positive and good ways. And of course, their emphasis on health has been good, and they're one of the largest international hospital groups, and they provide medical care and are known for that. So a lot of positive things came out of the Seventh-day Adventist. And that's good. Now, let's talk about the Church of God, Seventh Day. And if you notice these pictures, you notice how hair and dress styles have changed over the years. But I'm sure they would look at us and think we look quite strange and amusing as well. But anyway, Church of God, Seventh Day. A number of Sabbatarian Adventist churches in Michigan, Iowa, and Ohio could not accept the denominational name Seventh-day Adventist, citing that 12 times in the New Testament, the only name that is given for the true church is Church of God. They also agreed that the Bible alone was their guide, and they could not accept the visions of Ellen G. White as authoritative, and besides, she was female. Little bit of an issue as well there. So now it's interesting when you read the stories of the Seventh-day Adventist version of their history was this Marion party, they call them after Marion, Iowa, kind of described them as dissidents and splinter groups and rebels, and they told them to go away. But if you read the Church of God Seventh-day story, we stood up for the truth of God, and they fell away, and we remained true. So history is told differently by different groups. So if you read conflicting histories, that just means who's telling the story, and from their perspective. So a number of these churches have been founded by Gilbert Cranmer, who is sometimes given credit as the founder of the Church of God Seventh-day. But in the mid-1800s, the Marion, Iowa church, if you don't know where Marion, Iowa is, it's next to Cedar Rapids. If you don't know where Cedar Rapids is, it's in Iowa. But in the 1800s, the Marion, Iowa church published The Hope of Israel, promoting belief in an imminent return of Christ and the observance of the seventh-day Sabbath. By publishing and by camp meetings and conferences, their churches began to grow and began to spread. In 1884, a general conference was organized, and the name that they picked for their denomination was Church of God Adventist. Later, they changed the name to Church of God Seventh Day. In 1899, the denomination located its headquarters in Stanbury, Missouri, and incorporated there. In 1950, the headquarters moved to its present location in Broomfield, Colorado, which is near Denver. And I've had the pleasure of going up to their headquarters in Broomfield and meeting with their president, Wade Rose, and many of the others up there, and taking a tour of their publishing and so forth. And they're just wonderful, friendly people. Wade Rose has spoken at some of our festival sites in the past, and if as Joe was saying yesterday, if things are happening in Wade's life, I'm thrilled, because he's a wonderful man, and would love to see more transformation coming along. As Joe said, they invited us to come to their conference and tell our story, and then kind of said, don't come back. But again, this major sticking point is the Sabbath. It is a sticking point. Now, the Church of God Seventh Day struggles with Arianism. Their basic, I'd say, denominational belief is Binitarianism. Do you know what Binitarianism is, anybody? Two beings in the God family. That's their official. But some of them, some of their ministers and congregants are still Arian. They haven't even moved to Binitarian yet. I don't know that that's an improvement, but it's different. So, according to the Church of God Seventh-day website, the denomination has over 200 congregations in the United States and a worldwide membership of approximately 300,000. Now, the irony of this is, what did we used to call the Church of God Seventh-day in terms of church eras? Sardis. And we, Sardis is dead. And they said, excuse me? We're all over the world. We're bigger. We have more members, more publishing, more stuff, more than you've ever had in the history of your organization. And you say, we're dead. I don't get it. Where was I? Was it in Martinique? I can't remember. I think it was Martinique, where we were on our way to our services and passed two Church of God Seventh Days on the way to our one service on the island in Martinique. I don't know how many Church of God Seventh Days, but I was just impressed we passed two on the way. So I asked Wade Rose one time, I said, well, how many congregations do you have in the United States? He said, I don't know. We don't keep track. We ask for reports, but our pastors don't turn them in. And I said, I hear you, brother. We share a common ancestry, obviously. So the Church of God Seventh Day began with an Arian view, but had moved by the 1930s to more of a bi-theistic, binitarian view of God, that is, God family, which most members currently hold. For a while on the internet, you could actually hear one of their former presidents talking about how in the 1930s they began to realize that they had been wrong about the nature of God. And this is interesting because the president back then said, what we realize is that there is a father and a son. And he said, now I'm a father and I have a son and we have the same last name. But we're two separate beings in one family, father and son. And so that explains the nature of God. Do you see a fallacy in that line of reasoning? I mean, we always start with our human experience and reason back to God, right? So they developed the God family binitarian kind of perspective, which Herbert Armstrong later was to adopt. Herbert Armstrong started as a Trinitarian. It was only later in his ministry that he adopted the Church of God Seventh-day binitarian perspective. Maybe I'll talk about that a little more later. Now, this brings us to a man by the name of Greenberry G. Rupert. How many of you have heard of Greenberry G. Rupert? A few of you, perhaps? Okay, good. All right, well, the rest of you, get ready. Greenberry G. Rupert lived from 1847 to 1922. Rupert was a minister in the Seventh-day Adventist Church for 30 years and then was excluded from the church. We used a different term, disfellowshipped. He was excluded from the church for holding different doctrines. Now, Rupert believed in the Seventh-day Adventist doctrine, such as the Seventh-day Sabbath, soul sleep. Everybody know what I mean by soul sleep? No. When you die, you don't go to heaven. You just sleep in the grave until the resurrection. He believed in conditional immortality. In other words, you don't have an immortal soul. You don't have a spirit. You don't have anything that lives on after you die. You just die and nothing happens until the resurrection. He believed in annihilation in the lake of fire. The millennium, literal, 1,000 years. Futuristic prophecy, and the second coming of Christ. However, here's where he got in trouble with the Adventists. Rupert also believed and taught that Christians should observe the holy days of Leviticus 23. Because they revealed God's plan of salvation. Now, he was not the first. That line of thought goes way back. But it's always been very, very small. But Rupert made it much more popular. He believed that Christians should avoid the unclean meats of Leviticus 11 and Deuteronomy 14. He believed they should hold to the name Church of God for the name of God's one and only true church. They should avoid Christmas, Easter, and all other pagan observances. He believed that the United States and Britain should be understood as modern day Israel, and that the seven churches of Revelation 2 and 3 should be viewed as eras of the church. So when he espoused these doctrines, the Seventh-day Adventists excluded him, because those things had not been a part of the mainstream of Adventism. They had always flowed around the edges. They're not new ideas, but they'd always circulated at the margins. But now Rupert was trying to bring them into the core beliefs, and the Adventists did not accept those teachings as biblical. After his exclusion, Rupert began to fellowship with the Church of God Seventh Day. Okay, if the Adventists don't want me, I'll go to their nearest kin, the Church of God Seventh Day. So in 1913, Rupert wrote for the Church of God Seventh Day magazine, The Bible Advocate, and advocated the observance of the annual holy days. The Church of God did not accept Rupert's teaching on the holy days, or his notion that the United States and Britain were modern-day Israel. Others in the Church of God Seventh Day had claimed that many, many years before. They had never accepted that interpretation. And when Rupert brought it up again, they could not accept it either. So they rejected the holy days, and they rejected Anglo-Israelism. Interestingly, you might be interested to find this, well-marked copies of Rupert's literature with his teachings are in Herbert W. Armstrong's confidential files. Almost all of Herbert W. Armstrong's teachings appear to have been based on what Rupert taught and other marginalized thinking within the Adventist tradition. Herbert W. Armstrong had very few, if any, new ideas or new understandings or new doctrines. They were traditional Adventist, and particularly those formulated by Greenberry G. Rupert. Herbert W. Armstrong's talent appears to have lain in the effective repackaging of other people's interpretations and his ability to market those interpretations through publishing and radio. Greenberry G. Rupert did not have radio. Herbert Armstrong had radio and one of the finest radio voices ever. He was a brilliant marketer and a good repackager of material. What would have happened if Greenberry G. Rupert would have had radio and television? Don't know. We wouldn't be sitting here in this room today, probably, but this is the way it worked out. So Herbert Armstrong, I think very clearly, took at overwhelmingly most of everything he ever taught from Greenberry G. Rupert. And from whatever he didn't get from Rupert, he got from Adventist traditional teachings. However, what did Mr. Armstrong say? This is from his autobiography, 1967 version, and the year is around 1968 when he wrote this. This is volume one, Herbert W. Armstrong's autobiography. Just remember what we just discussed. I know of no one who was thrust into the ministry of Jesus Christ, untaught by man, but by the living Christ through his written word in the manner which I was. I didn't realize it yet, but I was being brought into his ministry by the living Christ in a manner utterly unique and totally unlike any other man. Okay. Then he said, this is from a co-worker letter, November 29th, 1954. And so I say to you, as the Apostle Paul said to those of Galatia, I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which is preached of me is not after man, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it by man, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Really? Well, I'm sure that's what he believed in his own mind, but the facts are quite different. had nothing new at all. That brings us to Herbert W. Armstrong. July 31st, 1892 to January 16th, 1986. We know the story, do we not? Part of our history. Oh, wait. How do we know history? From the perspective of those who wrote it. Keep that in mind. We know the story that in 1926, Loma was taught by Mrs. Ora J. Runcorn. Her name was Emma. Her husband's name was Ora. A little trivial point there. So she was Mrs. Ora, which I'm amused to find that Mr. Armstrong in his autobiography calls her an elderly lady. She was in her 50s. It's all a matter of perspective. It's all a matter of perspective. I'd call her a kid. So Loma was taught by Mrs. Runcorn about the seventh-day Sabbath, and at the same time, Herbert was challenged about evolution by his sister-in-law, Hertha Dillon. Now, so Mr. Armstrong, you know the story, he had to prove Loma wrong about the seventh-day Sabbath. So he framed his question on the Sabbath this way. Does God command Christians to worship on Saturday or Sunday? What happens if you ask the wrong question? You're going to get a wrong answer. You cannot get a right answer when you ask the wrong question. Do you know what was wrong with his question? He assumed that God commanded a day. Now, if you read the New Testament, can you find a command to keep Sunday? Well, of course not. But that's, you're going to come out with a wrong answer. So then he talks about his 6 months, we know the story, right? Virtual night and day, I'm quoting from him, virtual night and day, 7 days a week of intense study and research at the Portland Library. Now, I've been there several times now. It's now the Multnomah County Library. I've been upstairs. They even let me downstairs in the stacks, and they let me down to the old card catalog, which they've now replaced with a computer system, but it's at least the last time I was there, it was still there. So, but the sad thing about this is while he did this 7 days a week intensive research, and he says even after the library closed, he went home and studied into the wee hours of the morning, continuing to research at home. How much did he work during this 6 month time? If you read the autobiography, he tells you 30 minutes a week. He also tells you that his family went hungry, and that his children were crying, and that they were starving. But for 6 months, he was virtually unemployed and let his family go hungry. Why? He was on a mission from God. He was God's specially chosen anointed instrument who had to study these things and get these things figured out. A little glimpse into something. If you read the autobiography with open eyes, if you draw a timeline and begin to put things which he tends to put out of order in order, you begin to see a whole new thing without having to go anywhere else, just read Mr. Armstrong's own writings and own disclosures. So I had to ask the question as I read this carefully, why did he do that? And I'll just leave that hanging. Why did he do that to his family? Now, Herbert Armstrong says in the autobiography, at the end of the 6 month study, he knew what was the truth. We've heard that story. In the summer of 1927, Herbert Armstrong wrote an article called The Foundation for Sunday Sacredness Crumbles, in which he denounced worship on Sunday as pagan and an invention of the Roman Catholic Church. He wrote that God commanded Christians to observe the seventh-day Sabbath and thus not to observe it as a matter of sin and a matter of your salvation. However, in a letter to A.N. Duggar, an elder of the Church of God Seventh Day, dated February 23rd, 1928, year later, 2 years after his study, he remains uncertain with regard to Saturday versus Sunday. This is a document bearing a signature dated February 23rd, 1928. Mr. Armstrong writes, "It appears that the Bible," hear me, 1928, "it appears that the Bible abolishes the Sabbath and institutes nothing in the place of it. But it seems to us that some day should be kept. Scripturally, we believe the day kept is unimportant. But for ourselves, we prefer to keep the day which commemorates creation, which commemorates God's rest, the only day that God ever blessed and set apart to be kept. Therefore, we keep the seventh-day Sabbath, not because the Bible commands us to, not because it is in the law, but because we feel that it is more pleasing and acceptable to our God and Savior for us to keep that day. Therefore, we keep the Sabbath voluntarily. It is simply our personal preference. We do not feel there is any punishment attached to not keeping the Sabbath. We are not placing ourselves under the law, and we do not condemn others for keeping Sunday if they believe they should keep that day." What in the world? From 1926 to 1928, he's writing articles saying one thing, and then he's writing letters and notes that say something else. In August of 1928, Mr. Armstrong wrote to his grandparents, whom he called dear folks. Now, you got to remember what tradition were Herbert Armstrong's parents from? Quakers. And Quakers go to church on Sunday, and are they baptized? In the Spirit, but not in water, and they don't keep the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And yet Mr. Armstrong continually says his parents were two of the finest Christian people he'd ever known, and that they were good Christian folks and all this and that. So, but, I mean, his father wrote him letters about Sabbath keeping. "Herbert, what are you saying?" And Herbert would write back to his father, "Oh, Dad, don't worry about it. You're fine. You're the best Christian people I know. It's no big deal." While meanwhile, writing letters saying, you know, you're going to go to hell if you don't keep the Sabbath. Again, I ask, what was going on in this man's mind? And I do not believe he was insincere. I do not. So I ask the question, what was going on in his mind that he could approach life this way? August 1928, Mr. Armstrong wrote to his grandparents, and he said about Sabbath and baptism, because they were Quakers, "If you do not honestly feel sure in your own mind that God wants you to rest and keep holy the time between Friday and Saturday sunsets, it is not disobedience not to do it. I now realize it has nothing to do with salvation." Now, he then, later in 1928, wrote in a letter to A.N. Duggar again. He liked Duggar because Duggar was not the leader of the Church of God Seventh Day. He was the editor of the magazine, and Mr. Armstrong wanted to be published. So his big connection was with Duggar to get his material published in their magazine. So he expressed to Duggar his doubt about Saturday or Sunday. And he said, "Sooner or later, this question will be cleared up for me. The real truth will be revealed to me, whichever it is. I have prayed earnestly for it, and it is God's promise that a prayer of this kind is going to be answered." Still didn't know. Now, I'm going to jump ahead, so keep up with me here, because it follows this train of thought. How did Mr. Armstrong come to understand that God commanded us to worship on the seventh-day Sabbath, sunset to sunset? What did he say? How did he say he discovered that?
From God.
From God. 6 months study, revealed in God's Word, from Christ to him, out of the Bible. He proved it. He wrote a note to himself, which is in his files, which he dates as September or early October 1928. And he says how he finally came to prove that God wants us to keep the seventh day Sabbath. Here's how it happened. I began to wonder, hearing one of those things against it, that is keeping the seventh day Sabbath, whether I'm right or wrong. And so one time last autumn, in September, I believe, or early October, I prayed as I listened to a sermon on a Portland station. Now, you can realize that all during this time, Mr. Armstrong is going to the Hinton Memorial Baptist Church every Sunday and listening to radio preachers. I listened to a sermon on a Portland station as I prayed that God would give me some definite light on the subject that would clear my doubts for good. As the prayer came over the radio, given in the service at 11 a.m., where I had been listening for years, I continued on my knees praying this additional prayer of my own while the minister made announcements. Then, as he began his service, I arose and moved to my comfortable chair to listen. But before I reached it, the radio had gone dead. And I tuned into some other station thinking something was temporarily wrong and maybe I could get another sermon. There was no sound from the radio, though I turned in station after station from 0 to 100. I tried the radio several times until after 1 p.m. and when I could not get Dr. Pope, his favorite radio preacher, I gave up until late afternoon about 4 p.m. when the broadcast came in again. But in the meantime, I realized that I had been prevented from hearing any station up to the late afternoon. I took it as an answer to my prayer, since I had been prevented from keeping Sunday even to listening to a sermon. I had asked God to let me know in some definite, unmistakable way which day he wished us to keep for rest and worship, and I think there is no doubt about the answer. It came swift and sure. I could not worship that day, Sunday, and the radio had gone dead immediately after I had so prayed. That's the real story of how Herbert Armstrong proved that we are to keep the Sabbath, not Sunday. Now, I did some research in the Portland, Oregonian newspapers all through September and October of that year, and there was, at least on one date, though I can't say absolutely, but it's sounds more than a coincidence, that there was a citywide power failure, briefly, on a Sunday in Portland. So a few-hour power failure convinced Herbert Armstrong of God's mandate to keep the seventh-day Sabbath. Interesting. If his six-month intensive study, had not convinced him of the necessity of the Sabbath keeping for Christians, what did eventually convince him? The power failure. By 1927, Loma and Herbert, now I'm going back, if you notice, I'm backing up from 1928 to 1920. That's why important, if you ever read the autobiography and you want to study it, make sure you have a timeline, because he does the same thing. You know, if you tell a story, sometimes you have to go back in the story to fill in details, and he does that. By 1927, Loma and Herbert had begun to fellowship with the Church of God Seventh-day people and attended on Sundays the Hinton Memorial Baptist Church in Portland. John Dean was the pastor. Herbert Armstrong was baptized by Pastor Dean in May or June of 1927. He would not let a Church of God Seventh-day or Seventh-day Adventist pastor because he felt they were ungodly. He said John Dean was the most godly man in Portland. He was this Baptist. And Herbert Armstrong recommended that his brother Dwight and his parents be baptized and attend Hinton Memorial Baptist Church. And he did get Dwight over, but didn't get his parents. And he said, and the water is warm, to encourage them to come over. Next, Herbert Armstrong learned divine healing from members of the Four Square Gospel Church. Now, in the autobiography, you may remember Loma had all of these incidents, and he was afraid she was going to die, and a neighbor said, well, I know some people who believe God heals, and when they pray for people, they're healed. And he said, well, I don't want a lot of noise or commotion. He said, no, they're just quiet people. They'll come and pray. They came over and they prayed, and he said, I never heard such a prayer of faith and claiming the promise of God to heal. And they anointed her and prayed for her, and Loma was healed, and the wonderful people. Well, in his private court, they were members of the Four Square Gospel Church, Pentecostals. Now, that's ironic, because also in his autobiography, he read all of the terrible things he says about Pentecostals, that they're insincere, they don't know anything, they're just looking for a good time, they don't know the Bible. And yet, on the other hand, he says these two godly people claimed the promises of God, and Loma was healed, and so he looked into divine healing. The Church of God, Seventh Day, taught divine healing. So he was not unfamiliar with it, but he really was impressed by the Four Square Gospel approach to divine healing. So he began to listen to sermons by Amy Semple McPherson, and he called her his favorite preacher. Of course, he would not allow women in ministry, but Amy Semple McPherson was his favorite preacher. Interesting. And he found out from the Four Square movement that there was a place in Los Angeles called the Pisgah Home Movement, and they were supporters of Amy Semple McPherson and the Four Square Gospel Church, but they believed in the practice of anointing cloths. So Herbert Armstrong wrote to the Pisgah Home Movement and asked for anointed cloths. So up until the time he was ordained as an elder, he got all of his anointed cloths from Pentecostals, Pisgah Home Movement in Los Angeles, and they shipped them up to him, and he used them, and that's where he learned the practice of anointing cloths, even though the Church of God Seventh Day also believed in divine healing. Now, we know the story that he presented his work on the U.S. and Britain and prophecy to A.N. Duggar, and it was rejected. Now, the way he tells it is that A.N. Duggar was kind of the head of the Church of God Seventh Day, and he rejected his work. Now, A.N. Duggar was the publisher, and what he did was he said, I'm not going to publish this in the magazine. I mean, we had Greenberry G. Rupert. And we got rid of him, and we got rid of everybody who's ever said this. I mean, for decades, Adventists have been saying this, and we've rejected it. Herbert, we're not going to print your article. And how did Herbert interpret that? They rejected God, because they rejected my article, because I'm his instrument. And if you reject me, you reject God and this new truth, new light, which God has given me. Actually, the original title of his work was The Third Angel's Message, which was a very popular little buzz phrase in Adventist circles. But he later changed the Third Angel's Message title to The U.S. and Britain and Prophecy. So then he submitted his work on the Holy Days, and Duggar rejected that. He'd rejected Greenberry G. Rupert, rejected it. This is nothing new. We've rejected this before. Herbert, we're not going to print your article. Well, again, Herbert said, well, that's it. That proves it. They are not God's church anymore, because they won't publish my article, so they can't be God's church. In 1929, Herbert Armstrong wrote to Elder Hobbs of the Church of God Seventh Day that God had revealed to him that he was, this is 1929, that God had revealed to Mr. Armstrong that he was a special chosen instrument to reach the whole world with the true gospel. So while his family went hungry, he spent virtually all his time writing his manuscript on the third angel's message. So even after the 6 months intensive study, he continued to research and write and not work. And his family almost starved to death during that time period. So when Herbert Armstrong presented his work on the third angel's message, Duggar rejected it. Rejected his work on the Holy Days. The theories had been presented for decades and had always been rejected. But for Herbert Armstrong, this was his dual test of whether the Church of God was the one true church. In his confidential memoirs, Herbert Armstrong wrote that by rejecting God's chosen instrument on earth, himself, the Church of God had rejected God, and they were no longer the one true church. Therefore, a new church will have to begin. In 1933, Herbert Armstrong founded a church. This is the first church founded by Herbert Armstrong, and you might say, if you want to call it a denomination or the beginning of a denomination, here's our denominational name, first one. He applied to the Secretary of State of Oregon and said, Church of God, Eugene, Oregon. He said, that's taken. So he reapplied and he submitted West 8th Street Church of God, Eugene, Oregon. That was accepted. So the first name, and I'm saying this a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but the first name of our denomination was West 8th Street Church of God, Eugene, Oregon. So we've changed our name more than once. For sure. By 1934, his church was sponsoring his radio program called the Radio Church of God. See, that often gets mistaken. That was not the name of the church. That was the name of the radio program sponsored by the West 8th Street Church of God. They adopted it as their media outreach. However, in March 3rd, 1946, Herbert Armstrong and a few others traveled to Sacramento, California, unknown to most of the members of the West 8th Street Church of God, Eugene, Oregon, and incorporated a new church called the Radio Church of God, a not-for-profit California corporation. And I'm told that the members were shocked when they found out that he had left them to start a new church in California. Then in 1968, the name was changed to Worldwide Church of God. On January 16th, 1986, Herbert W. Armstrong died. Joseph DeCotch Sr. became Pastor General. On September 23rd, 1995, Joseph DeCotch Sr. died, and Joseph DeCotch Jr., now you drop the junior after the senior has died, became Pastor General, and in 2009, the name was changed to Grace Communion International. Mr. Armstrong, from very early on, wrote in his personal papers that God had called him to raise up an international organization with colleges, owning real estate, and with a worldwide ministry, because he was God's special chosen agent on earth. He knew that in the late 20s and early 30s. Now, whatever you may think about him, you've got to admit he had vision. And doggone, if I may use that word again, forgive me, I'd do that to be funny, he pulled it off. Wow, that's pretty impressive for that kind of visionary thinking and then to actually bring it about. But that all, what did that do to his mind? It confirmed all the more that he was who he thought he was, a very special, unique, most important man on the face of the earth. Now, it's interesting, again, if you read his autobiography carefully, just to understand Mr. Armstrong. I got behind in my slides there, but you have them. He goes to Altoona, Iowa, I believe it is, where he is hired as a busboy or waiter at a hotel. And he talks about how the owner just praised him effusively. And he said, for the first time in my life, I felt worthwhile. What does that tell you? And he was about 16, 17 years of age. Something went wrong in his childhood that he didn't feel that until this man told him. Yeah. And then he said, if you read the autobiography, but immediately my head became filled with cockiness and conceit, and I thought I was the most important man in the world. But how do you think that way? You know, what leads to that type of thinking? I think, you know, probably we all have our ideas, but understanding Herbert W. Armstrong, I have not done this little particular session before with anyone, so you're the first to hear this, but trying to understand Herbert Armstrong. Now, as I said, Zondervan will tell you he's insignificant. Well, that's because he didn't have an impact in their lives. And thank God, so many in our denomination today don't even know who he was. So it's in the past and all that. But for some of us who knew him, I knew him. I've been in his home. I've had meals with him. My two older children have sat in his lap, and he's hugged them. And, you know, so Barbara and I have had some experience, and so have many of you. And Carr and Kathwood had a very close relationship with Loma. And I mean, we've known this man, and we've looked. So we have something to deal with maybe in our history and for that reason. So let's try to understand Herbert Armstrong. And I'm neither him to, as I have said before, I'm neither here to condemn him nor to deify him. And frankly, I do not want my life story told. Thank you very much. Just stay out of my life. Don't analyze me, please. Can you imagine someday someone doing a seminar on you? So let's understand that, and let's be very generous and very kind and very loving and compassionate and inclusive as we should be. But for our own sakes and for those who have been touched by the life of Mr. Armstrong, I think we need some kind of understanding of who this man was. And if you want to take notes, I will give you a date and I will give you a page number in the autobiography and a copyright date. Now, there are different versions of the autobiography. So I will tell you the copyright date of the one and the page number that I'm going to quote from. And if you're that curious, you can go back and read all this for yourself. Let me begin by a date that he says it was 1918. And this is from the 1967 autobiography, page 221. 1918, 1967 autobiography, page 221. He says, I seem to have my off days and my on days. And he will describe how sometimes for a month or longer, he could do nothing. Then he would have manic periods where he could produce prodigious amounts of work, but then he would fall back into not being able to do anything. What does that tell you? That sounds bipolar. Sounds bipolar, it does. Then in 1920, this is, unless I tell you otherwise, around 1967 autobiography, volume 1, page 234. And he says, the flash depression of late 1920 wiped out my business and began, you know, as he talks about, 28 years of poverty. He just could not recover because you know how the 1920s were. The roaring 20s. Excuse me. The roaring 20s is a term sometimes used to refer to the 1920s, characterizing the decade's distinctive cultural edge in cities such as Chicago, which is where Mr. Armstrong was living. Economically, the era saw the large-scale diffusion and use of automobiles, telephones, motion pictures, and electricity, unprecedented industrial growth, accelerated consumer demand and aspirations, and significant advances in lifestyle and culture. The Roaring Twenties, one of the most economic prosperous times in our nation's histories. And Mr. Armstrong says, I couldn't find work, and I lost my business, and what was I to do? What does that tell you? What kind of a person in the face of the greatest economic prosperity in our nation's history tells you it was a time of doom and gloom and you can't get work? Depression. Yeah, you'd have to say that's a depressed state. He describes on page 235, 28 lean years of virtual poverty that would follow his loss of his business in 1920. Interesting. Now, you may remember, too, I don't have this down in my notes, but remember he said that he got so depressed after he lost his business that he began frequenting, drinking alcohol and staying out till 2 in the morning and hanging out with people. And he said, I didn't get drunk, but I drank too much. Well, what was that period also? Prohibition. So that means he was where? Illegal speakeasies run by the mafia in Chicago. Now, he doesn't mention that, but that's where it had to be because that's the only place you could get illegal alcohol and stay out till 2 in the morning. Interesting. But what do you do when you're depressed? You drink. You drink. That's what you do. I mean, that's just a part of depression, to try to medicate. Self-medication, it's called. So this is page 239, July 1922. He says, I had to give up an apartment. Loma and the girls had already moved to Iowa with their parents. So he sent Loma and the girls home to Loma's parents in Iowa, and he had an apartment, but finally he had to give up his apartment. And he talks about he moved from rooming house to rooming house to he just had to leave one before the rent was due and move to another and leave it before the rent was due and leave behind all of these landlords wondering where he had gone. Then on page 240, July 1922, he says, this was the blackest and most discouraging 3 months of my life. And he describes the cabarets and alcohol. And so finally he moved to Iowa with Loma's parents so there would be no cost of living. That's what he says. So, as he says in the autobiography, from October 1922 to March 1923, this is on page 240, I rested and tried to recuperate my morale. For 5 months, he rested and tried to recuperate his morale while they lived off Loma's parents. Again, what does that say? How would you interpret that? I mean, we're not, maybe some of us are licensed psychologists, I don't know, but how would you interpret that? It just as a layperson? Very depressed, yeah. And this is what, in the bipolar thing, this is the very depressed state of mind you find yourself in. Page 262, in the summer of 1923, he was offered a job, but he turned it down. Do you remember why he said he turned it down? He said, I'm a lone wolf. I can't work with people. That's his exact words. I'm a lone wolf. I can't work with people. And I work in streaks. And he was afraid that, you know, he'd work in a streak and then couldn't, and then he'd be fired and he'd be right. So he just didn't even take the job. Continuing on those same pages, 1924, June 16th, the family departed for Oregon to live with Herbert Armstrong's parents. Loma says, he says in the autobiography, Loma told him, I've got to get you out of here. We need a change of pace. It's 5 months. So let's at least go to Oregon and we'll live with your parents. And I'm sure the Dillons went, thank you. And by this time, he had been 4 years virtually unemployed. From July of 1924 to the fall of 1926, pages 280 and 284, if you put them together, he worked approximately 6 months in advertising. So once he got to Oregon, he did get to work, but he worked only 6 months. In 1926, the fall, on page 284, his business was gone. Why did he lose these businesses in the roaring 20s, one just has to ask. And he says he worked only 30 minutes a week. He says, quote unquote, I was crushed in spirit. Quote unquote, I had nothing but time on my hands. That's why he said, so I embarked upon an intensive 6 month study, because after all, I had nothing but time on my hands. Well, what's your family going to do, Herbert? Well, Mom and Dad will take care of them. I've got to study. Page 330, 1927. After the 6 months intensive study, Herbert Armstrong continued to study all day, every day at the Portland Library. No job. From 1927 to 1930, pages 343, 344, he did a night and day study for the next 3.5 years, he says. Night and day study, no job. From 1927 to 1930, pages 281, 344, 351, 355 and 506, this is why you got to draw a timeline. His family was reduced to going hungry. This is what he says. We had no money for rent, gas, or electricity. We had only water to drink. The children, quote unquote, were crying with hunger. This was the time that he was writing the third angel's message and his paper on the holy days. Even he made up a dummy copy of a magazine he called The Plain Truth that he hoped someday to be able to publish. And he even wrote articles for it while he was unemployed and his family was hungry and the children were crying for food. So while his family went hungry to pay for it, he mentions that. He says, my family sacrificed. They went hungry so that I could have a professional artist design the front cover for The Plain Truth. Have you read the autobiography carefully? 1928, pages 358, 359. Herbert Armstrong turns down another job offer. Why? Quote, the job was distasteful. And I only work in spurts. I might go into a slump for a week or a month in which I would accomplish nothing. 1929, pages 362, 363. Quote, another crisis of hunger and desperate need for my family. But how did he solve that? He prayed. So Herbert Armstrong says, I prayed and our family was saved by a quote unquote mysterious woman who came to the door and offered him a job throwing in wood. You get a little mental picture of how he's thinking and how he views the world, his worldview. However, January 1930, pages 372 and 373, quote, we were completely out of food, out of wood for fuel to keep warm, and it was winter. So what do you do? He prayed. And his father brought food and wood. They were now living out of the house. So his father came over with food and wood for Herbert and Loma and the children. His brother Russell loaned him a car. Times were so bad, but have you noticed that his parents were doing fine and having to help Herbert and his family? Russell was doing fine and had an extra car to loan Herbert. Herbert was the one who wasn't making it. And bless his family, they helped him out. But February 1930, page 376, a second son, Garner Ted, was born during this period of hunger and desperate need. And remember, the doctors had told him not to have another child because it would kill Loma. When his son Richard David was born, he said, it was the happiest day of my life because God had finally given me a son. That's in the autobiography. I thought, what do Beverly and Dorothy think when they read that? What, are we chopped liver, Dad? And then he goes on to talk about his sons. That had to hurt, I would think. But anyway, 1930, early summer, pages 378, 379, Mrs. Armstrong did not have enough to eat and had no milk for the baby and no money to buy any. So what do you do?
Pray.
And trusted that God would provide, because after all, you know who I am. God will take care of my family. I don't have to because of who I am. 1930-ish, pages 382 and 383, Herbert W. Armstrong sells aluminum cookware, but his father still has to pay his rent. October 1930, page 384, Herbert and his family had to leave their home in Portland and move back in with his parents in Salem. 1931, page 394, he's selling aluminum cookware, but he says, not making enough to meet the actual needs of my family, just enough to keep us from starving. And that's while he's still living with his parents. June 1931, page 407, Herbert Armstrong was ordained by the Oregon Conference of the Church of God Seventh Day. And you see in there a picture of his ordination certificate and all of that. Now, interestingly, if you also read, Mr. Armstrong says, I was never a member of the Church of God Seventh Day. So I wrote to them and they said, we don't ordain people who are not members of our church. Of course he was a member of our church. But it's a different point of view. He says he received no money, if you recall, from them. However, they showed me copies of expense vouchers and checks. He got a salary and expenses from the Church of God Seventh Day. Then he began to receive pay and expenses from the Church of God Seventh Day. That helped the family a great deal by 1931. And he began to find some work again in advertising. 1932, pages 453, 454, he says the family still did not have enough to eat, though. But now Herbert Armstrong begins to understand about tithing and the financial blessings from obedience. Okay, so tithing and blessings from obedience and 28 years of poverty and suffering. That's cognitive dissonance is what you call that. 1940, now we're moving way ahead now, 1940, we've come a long ways. April, this is the 1987 edition of the autobiography, page 8. In a letter to co-workers, Herbert Armstrong says, quote, the only way I have managed to keep this work going has been by personal sacrifice. Taking money intended for our family living, and by letting my family suffer. One of my daughters has had to stop school. We are about to lose our home, and we have gone without badly needed clothing. Why? Then in 1944, January, page 94, this year we faced the most serious financial crisis so far. Co-workers have failed to rise to meet this financial emergency. So, in a sense, whose fault is all this? The co-workers. They need to cough up more dough. So, February 1944, pages 94 and 95, we were forced to sell our home. We were literally out on the street. And whose fault is it? The co-workers. From the summer of 1944 to July 1947, 3 years, the family had no home and were forced to move, quote unquote, from one auto court to another every 3 days. Eventually, by 1947, able to stay in a rooming house. Page 98, Mr. Armstrong says, life, this was not family life at all. What do you think of a man who says, this was not family life at all? Wow. However, Herbert Armstrong states that during the years of 1940 to 1947, that's the same time period, if you notice, of all the things I've just told you. Think about that now. What was he doing from 1940 to 47 during this time period of great suffering, losing their home, starving to death, motor court to motor court? Mr. Armstrong states that during the years 1940 to 1947, he did a great deal of traveling, page 99. Well, if he did a great deal of traveling, then who was back home suffering? The wife and the kids. According to his autobiography, he frequently traveled to Los Angeles, Seattle, Des Moines, Chicago, San Antonio, Denver, New York, and Washington, D.C., among other cities, utilizing church funds to do so. And as you know, according to the way he was taught, he stayed in the finest hotels, traveled first class, and ate the best meals, while Loma and the children nearly starved back at home. What is going on? Page 99, Mr. Armstrong states, frequently I made trips through those years to Hollywood. He also states, page 88, with regard to his visits to Hollywood, for a period of 2 to 6 weeks each time. So Mr. Armstrong is in a hotel in Hollywood for 2 to 6 weeks, and the family is in Oregon sacrificing for the work. In the summer of 1941, Herbert Armstrong and his 20-year-old daughter Dorothy spent time together in Los Angeles. 4 months. 4 months. In April of 1942, Herbert Armstrong traveled to Hollywood, taking his now 21-year-old daughter Dorothy with him. Herbert Armstrong and Dorothy lived together in a small apartment in Hollywood from April to July, while Loma tried to keep the work going in Eugene and tried to feed her three hungry children. In his confidential diary, Mr. Armstrong states that during these years, he took long trips, frequently taking his teenage to 20-year-old daughter with him as he traveled about the United States, while Loma and Beverly and Richard and Garner Ted were at home going hungry. He says during this 4 months in Hollywood, for the first 2 weeks, I did a once-a-week recording of a half-hour radio program.
Wow.
For the remainder of the 4 months, he did a daily half-hour radio program. Now, in June of 1942, Loma sent Richard to Hollywood because she could no longer control him, page 54 to 55. So she just put him on a bus, sent him down to his father. Herbert Armstrong, it's in the autobiography, citing that he was busy with the radio broadcast each day. I mean, good grief, it took half an hour. Now, I know there's preparation, you know, I understand that. He sent 13-year-old Richard off in Southern California, and he says this in the autobiography, find your own way. He's 13 years old in Southern California in Hollywood, Los Angeles, and go. And don't come back till dinner. 13 years old. He sent him off, he says this, to Santa Monica. Oh, if you know the area, that's a long way. How in the heck do you even, if I were in Hollywood and I had to get to Santa Monica without a car, I would be confused and I don't know, that's a long ways. But then he says to Oceanside. Oceanside is down near San Diego. You're sending a 13-year-old boy 3 hours down the coast? How's he get there? How does he live? I don't know. But that's what he says. He sent him to Oceanside. Sent him to the zoo and told him to find his way back at night. According to receipts and diary entries found in Herbert Armstrong's confidential files, Herbert Armstrong traveled frequently in the late 1930s through much of the 1940s. So all of this suffering he describes was not his. He wasn't even there much of the time. On these travels, he stayed at first-class hotels, his receipts show that, and ate expensive meals. And frequently, until her marriage on July 22, 1944, he took his daughter Dorothy with him on the trips, which lasted from weeks to months. While Herbert Armstrong and Dorothy traveled, back in Eugene, the rest of the Armstrong family was going hungry and struggling to make rent and utility payments. What does this information lead you to conclude about Herbert W. Armstrong? I leave that to you. And basically, all I've told you is in the autobiography.
What was the date he bought the property in Pasadena?
1947. And then they moved there. Interesting story. I'm not a psychologist. As I say, I'm a doctor, but not the kind who can help anybody. I'm not a psychiatrist or not a psychologist, but I have consulted with psychiatrists and psychologists and have done some reading, so I'll share with you what I think. And I just ask you to, you know, deal with this and interpret it in your own way. I believe that at first I thought Mr. Armstrong was bipolar, that first quick conclusion. But talking with others, they said, no, what you're describing and all his material points to the narcissism. He was a narcissist. And they said the symptoms are almost identical to bipolar, but they're not bipolar. They can't be treated with drugs. Well, they can be, but not the same kind of drugs. But he was a narcissist. But many great leaders are narcissists. And that's what their leadership, because they have vision. And they believe in themselves. Oh, do they believe in themselves? Yes. And so you see that narcissistic trait that I am the most important man in the universe. And as we know, our friend Roderick Meredith once said, I heard him say this, I imagine Karn heard him say this, a number of us heard him say this, I'm the third most important man in the universe. Now that's a line of narcissistic thinking that you know that other people would laugh and ridicule, and yet we go, yeah, we believe that. I believed that at one time. And then I have to ask the question, so what's wrong with me that I believe that? But yeah, I believe that Mr. Armstrong suffered from narcissism. And I'd ask the question, what if that had been understood and he had been treated? Well, we wouldn't be here today and none of this would have happened. So does God lead you through the wanderings and the wilderness to get you to the... In other words, we all have to work this out in our minds. What does this all mean? But the good news is we're here today. And God loves Herbert Armstrong. And who among us let those who were without sin cast the first stone? But I think we have to understand him as a man, not as God's apostle, not as the one and only, not as a unique man, not even as a theologian or original thing, a great marketer, a good advertising man, a wonderful radio voice, a commanding presence, and many good things, but a lot of bad things. And my heart just goes out to his family. But wait for the great reconciliation
to come. Is that the same with David?
It's the same with many people. Yeah.
Boys.
Well, this is what we learn, fellow pastors and leaders. Don't do that. Amen. Don't do that, because you can get so caught up in your leadership and your work and your ministry and who you are and your identity becomes all that you don't notice the people around you. That's happened to many Christian leaders. Mr. Armstrong is not the only one who has walked that. But we need to learn and not do that. So I think I've neither deified nor I hope demonized, but said that he was a troubled man like many of us. And with proper therapy, he could have been treated in the family. But that just didn't happen in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. And so he did what he did, but yet we all came to know God and a lot of other good things as a result of even that. God, as Mr. Armstrong used to say, quote him, God can turn lemons into lemonade by his miraculous power, yes. I think each of us has to make those kinds of analyses and work it out in our mind in a healthy and positive way. And as I said, I hope that you have found this not hurtful, even though it is a bit, but I hope it's also therapeutic that we realize that Herbert W. Armstrong was a man. No more, no less. Just like you and me, he was a man with his problems, with his troubles, with his faults, and with his virtues. He was just a man. In fact, as I wrote in my dissertation at the end, I said, and so it's like in The Wizard of Oz, the great and powerful Oz. But when you pull back the curtain, it's just a man. Okay. Comments, questions? Yes.
directly from his words, how are we, somebody that's able to look at him as most revered, honored, how can we be able to maintain that image? Did none of this stuff ever come up?
That's a good question, Ellis. Karn, do you want to speak to that? How did he manage to keep that under, some of those things under wraps?
I don't think he did fully. My concept going back into the 50s is that we had an imperfect leader who could have bad days when he would yell and scream and lose his temper. And I'd never seen anyone lose their temper. He also had good days when he was kind and grandfatherly and loving, and I've been the recipient of that. So my reaction was, he is imperfect, and God will take care of it. This is the true church. He's his chosen apostle, and somehow with time, it will all work itself out.
Right.
And it did, actually, but it just took longer.
Yeah, the earlier students were closer to it, and I maybe Karn might agree or disagree with this, but what I have observed as a historian, but also kind of in the midst, is noticing that the early students saw those things and then began to hide them, because after all, their identities were hidden in him. So they had to protect him, and to build up Herbert Armstrong was to build up yourself. So you cast your fate with him, so it's very important to keep him on the pedestal, and so maybe some of us have to take some blame because he began to believe what we said about him. And so it's a self-perpetuating almost kind of thing there, so interesting. Yes, even then, Ole? Yes.
Yeah, I would like to say early, the thing that impressed me more than anything else, despite some of the nasty things said by people like me, was that the Bible is the Word of God. And I remember the thing that really impressed me was the incident where Garner Ted Armstrong had started gone off and didn't want to repent. And he said, the Word of God is the final word. And then Mr. Jackson encouraged me by saying, because I had some concerns, he said, just remember this, God will straighten it out. And I realized the thing that was so impressive was the Bible is the final word of God, and we ultimately, as Christians, must submit to that once we learn it. So you sort of, you put some of those things aside, realizing he's a human being. I remember that. But you couldn't say that in those times, because if you did, where I was in Chicago, you were branded as having a bad attitude. So I just listened and went on.
Okay, well, I appreciate your comment. I just think, can I turn this maybe more positive for just a few moments before we dismiss, maybe?
Yes,
thank you. And talk a little bit. And then if we have time left, I'll take more comments. But how did we come to be who we are today? Okay, by God's grace, transformation. And a quick synopsis of the story, of course, is that Joseph DeCotch Sr. said that I can't fit in his shoes, but I will follow in his footsteps. But Joe DeCotch Sr. was not the same man as Herbert W. Armstrong. So when some criticisms and other things began coming up, rather than rebuking them and saying, I'm God, don't you know who I am? I'm God's apostle. He said, well, let's figure this out. Let's look at this, and if it's right, it's right. And if we proved it once and it's true, we can prove it again. Well, that began to undo some things when you take that perspective. And some of the minor things make up, you know, healing, a few things like that. Of course, remember, Mr. Armstrong was attended by doctors and nurses 24 hours a day. He had all kinds of medications and equipment. And while we taught that God alone heals, and that's sin. So some change had to come, huh? Obviously. We taught that interracial marriage, well, first of all, we taught divorce was wrong. But he divorced, so we had to change that. We taught that interracial marriage was wrong, but he married a lady who has a Native American heritage. Had to change that. I mean, some things were necessary to change in light of what Mr. Armstrong did. So go figure that one for a while. But the big change was when the Catholic priest in Australia who was loved reading the plain truth, but we published this short little article on the Trinity, of course denying the Trinity and all this and that and the other thing and making our usual ridiculous arguments about it. And he wrote a letter in to the to our letter answering department that said, I like your magazine, I like you, but this article you just wrote on the Trinity is ridiculous. You don't, first of all, you try to disprove that. You don't even understand the Trinity. You can't even say what it is, and yet you say it isn't. So he said, I am sorry, but you are so out of touch with this and this and that. And so it was a well-written, well-documented, cited thing that he said. And so our letter answering department didn't know what to do. So they brought it to Mike Fazell, saying, well, let's take this to Mike Fazell. And Mike Fazell said, wow, I don't know what to do with this. If I take this to Mr. DeCotch, heads will roll. I'm not taking this to him. So he said, let me take it to Joe Jr., among other people. And he said, so Joe, what do you think about the Trinity? Well, Mike, what do you think about the Trinity? No, I ask you first. So they both saw there was something that they both were kind of seeing in their studies and all this. They said, well, let's ask Stavronides. He'll have the answer, if you know Dr. Stavronides and his Greek background. Yeah. And so they said, so Dr. Stavronides, what do you think? Oh, the Trinity is true, clearly. What? Oh, yeah. You know, historically, biblically, theologically, philosophically, it has to be, it's true. Oh, man, we can't tell Mr. DeCotch that. So they finally got up and said, look, we got to go to Mr. DeCotch Sr. with this. And so they, you know, gingerly presented that to him and then waited for the wrath of DeCotch to fall. But the background of the story was is that Mr. DeCotch's, I believe it was father-in-law, who was Greek, if I remember, if I get it all straight, had long, even though became a member of the Radio Church of God, held to the Trinity because he's Greek. Father? Was it his father, his Russian father?
His father was Russian, but he spoke seven languages.
Okay, all right. Okay, thank you, Karn. So it was his father who spoke seven languages, yeah. Said, is that? And so when the ministers would come over to visit, as you know we did, and said, do you have any questions? Well, Papa would try to raise the issue, and Joe DeCotch Sr. would go, Papa, no, he just don't bring that up anymore. But he said he was a faithful, you know, member, except convinced of that. And so when they brought this to Joseph DeCotch Sr. and they expected a reaction, his reaction was, well, what do you know? Papa was right all along. And to me, that was a key piece of transformation. And then we had to try, and then we tried to explain something we didn't understand. And then people said, well, you're all mixed up, and you say one thing. Yeah, because we know it's right, but we're so unused to this, it's going to take us a while to even develop the vocabulary to properly explain this. And so we did, and we went through the process. And, of course, then after that, one thing after another began to take place until, I remember, 1994. Oh, December 14th, 1994, Clayton County Performing Arts Center, Clayton County, Georgia. With Calhoun's, were you there? I was there. Barbara was there. I don't know if any of the rest of you were there, but we're there. And Joe DeCotch came out to deal with a problem in the field. Gave a 3-hour sermon, going back to Abraham, giving us the meta-narrative of the Abrahamic covenant and all the way down. And finally, in the last 10 or so minutes of the 3-hour presentation, he said, so what did we come to see here today? Well, one is, it is not required to keep the seventh-day Sabbath for salvation. Ooh. It is not required to keep the seven holy days for salvation. Ooh. It is not required to tithe, first, second, third tithe for salvation. Oh. And out in the halls after, there were several thousand of us there that day because all the Atlanta churches were present. And out in the hall, I'm not kidding you nor exaggerating, this is the honest truth as best as I can relay it, is the discussions were all of what in the world, what did we just hear? This is crazy, where are we going, what's happened to us? Not keep the seventh-day Sabbath, God commands that, it's the law of God. What is he saying? Not keep the holy days, well, they're right there in the Bible and God commands them, we've got to do that, that's real. And not tithe, now that makes sense. That's the honest truth, I remember. That one was easy to grasp. Yes, the booklet God Is ... began to come out, and a number of other things, and but then thanks be to God, the transformation was in place, and then I remember this, and you know, Mike Fazell, I think, remembers it a bit, but that's the way it is. It's how you remember it, how you tell the story. So it's my story. I'm here. I get to tell it. All right. But I remember when. We fired the president of Ambassador University in Big Sandy for, you know, obvious doctrinal reasons, and Russell Duke became president of Ambassador University, but that left a vacancy in the New Testament chair, which Russell had been. And because of accreditation, we needed a PhD to be the chair of the New Testament department, but we didn't have any then. And so we wondered what to do, so I believe it was Mike Fazell asked Earl Grant at Azusa Pacific University, who was a good friend of ours, and was the director of the Doctor of Ministry program. He said, we need a PhD, but of course you know who we are. We need someone who will fit with us and won't freak out. And you know, is there anybody like that who has their credentials and the background and could take this and interact with us and our transformation? He said, I know a man. His name is John McKenna.
Yes.
So John McKenna came in to be interviewed, and as we talked and all that, John McKenna said, well now, Earl Grant told me not to tell you these things. Here they are. But we liked what he said, you know? And then I remember it this way, Mike Fazell said, well John, you know, here's our journey, here's what's happened to us. God's led us to this point. We've been transformed. We know we're evangelical Christians. We know that's broadly who we are, where we fit in the United States. We're evangelical Christians. However, we've been Arminian, and I don't have time to explain those terms if you don't know them. Ask someone later if you're not familiar, but we've been Arminian, but all that led us to was legalism and perfectionism and do's and don'ts and guilt and all of that. And we don't want to go there anymore at all. We know it's not up to us. It's not our decisions. It's not our growing and overcoming. It's God and it's Jesus. And we've never been Calvinistic, and we're not going there. We're not five-point Calvinist by any stretch of the imagination, but neither are we Arminian, and we're not Lutheran. And there's nothing left within Protestantism. You're either Arminian, Calvinist, or Lutheran. We're none of those. Who are we? And he explained our heart, our compassion, that we've always believed that God would give everyone a chance. We've always believed that God loves everyone and that all will have an opportunity for... We've always believed that in our hearts. And as he explained all that, John, I remember John McKenna saying, well, I know who you are. But I'm not going to tell you. You need to discover it for yourself. But he said first, I recommend you read the early church fathers, Irenaeus, Athanasius, and all the others. Read the Cappadocian fathers. And I suggest you start reading the works of Karl Barth, MacDonald, Torrance family, say a few others. And he said, and then just see who you think you are. So I remember Joe began reading the Patristics, and Mike began reading Barth and the Torrances, and then we were, oh, this is who we are. We didn't even know there was such a thing, but it's here, and it's been here since Irenaeus. It's been here since, really, the New Testament, but it's been in the early church. It's been kind of forgotten. It's more in the East than it was in the West, but we do have a heritage, and we are somebody, and it's a good thing that God has led us. What a journey this has been through all that we discussed here this morning to the wonderful point we are today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I'm going to conclude there. If some of you want to come up and talk, I'll be glad to listen to what you have to say. But thank you for coming, and I hope it has been therapeutic and a blessing, and that the pain was not too great.